Coach, I'm going to ask you questions much like you did Coach Wooden. I use the alphabet as my memory jogger the exact same way you did for Coach Wooden. I started with A and worked all the way through Z. And so I have some questions for you. I'll ask them, and feel free to take as long as little as you want.
All right.
A, first word that came to mind, and A, that I thought that you could help share some inspiration with, was the word accountable. How do you keep yourself and your players accountable?
I think by doing what you did today in a speech, and I'm not throwing bouquets your way because I'm here listening to you speak, but I think you have to be accountable, you have to make them see you, make yourself transparent to them. Don't set a false scenario of yourself or a false image. Or who do you, there was an old Catholic priest one time, the ex-coach I was talking about, and the thing I liked about him, he never was holier than thou. He told us about his flaws, so when you went and talked to him, you felt like he was real. He was accountable to me.
You know, as a leader, we have to be accountable to the people we're leading, right? And so all too often, I think leaders...
Hold on. Would you do me a favor? Would you get the largest megaphone, or I'll put you on the next plane. Would you go to Washington, D.C. and tell those politicians exactly what you're saying?
Yeah.
It's deductive reasoning.
Yeah.
Yes, absolutely yes.
Well, you know, it's... Okay, so on B, the word that jumped out to me is brilliance. How important is brilliance in the game plan, or is there another characteristic? In the game plan, when you're crafting a winning game plan, whether it be on the field or on the court or in life, how important is brilliance to that?
You know, it's amazing. I always drift back to Coach Wooden on things. Brilliance is a category by itself that can be self-absorbing, and you can be brilliant, but can you deliver that brilliance? Can you communicate with people? And I remember Coach Wooden telling me as a young coach, first year at LSU, he said, don't try to be some coaching genius or guru and confuse them. Practice simplicity with constant repetition. That's brilliance in itself.
The irony of it is that is the brilliance, right? Mm-hmm. All too often we hear these convoluted ideas and theories and philosophies that we just can't make common sense out of. And I wanted mostly for our listeners and for everyone else to hear, you don't have to be brilliant to win.
That's right.
And in fact, most
That's
things
right.
that are brilliant are
right.
Just really that. They're great theories and great.
You sound like Coach Wooden.
Well,
you know, I read something also by him. They were interviewing him one time about, you got to be the most brilliant coach in the world and what have you. That he said, I'm not trying to be humble what I'm going to say to you. But he said, that wasn't my success. He said, I was able to play the right players and get them to play together.
Yeah.
So if there wasn't any brilliance in my career, it was in that area.
The lesson that he shared with me and that you shared with me when he said his first practice was teaching how to put their socks
That's
in
right.
Shoes on.
That's right.
Because if you don't learn how to put on your socks and shoes,
yeah.
then you're going to get a blister. And if you get a blister, you don't perform. That he would make them learn to pass the ball before he'd let them shoot the ball.
Mm-hmm.
Those are the types of game plans that I see that win,
right.
particularly in business.
No question.
And that's why I'm sitting down with you.
No question.
So
no question.
Coaches. Too often you hear these plans, the healthcare plan, the jobs plan, they're convoluted, you know, these $1 trillion bailout packages, and
right.
think these guys are brilliant, they'll solve our problems for us, but they don't. Okay, on to C. So courage. How do you inspire courage against the odds?
Courage is not always displayed with demonstrativeness or pugilistic. Courage is the ability to continue. Courage and perseverance are kind of intertwined, but the courage to do something, not worried about what anybody else is going to think about it. And that's summed up again. I hate to make this a John Wooden interview,
yeah.
but John Wooden said so brilliantly again. He said, the problem with us, he said, we're trying to have a reputation. What are reputations like? He said, your reputation is what others perceive you to be,
yeah.
but your character is who you are when you lay down at night and go to bed.
Yeah.
That's your true character. So courage is the ability of all odds, no matter what anybody says, no matter what the situation, whether it be, what cycle are you, to get back up every day. Courage, perseverance, the courage to do something.
courage. Okay, on to D, discipline. You are very disciplined.
Wow.
How do you hold others to a standard of discipline when yours is so high? So for example, you conduct yourself a certain way as a coach. You expect of yourself, you're going to wake up early in the morning, you're going to exercise, you're going to tune in your mind, tune in your body, and you have this high standard of discipline in your life, and you have a player, a teammate, a colleague, a friend, a family member that doesn't hold themselves to that same level of discipline. How do you deal with that?
Discipline is getting people to do things that they don't want to do, but they think they're doing it. They're not being led to do it. They're initiating themselves. And I find out that the discipline, so many people, I mentioned earlier today, I remember if a coach would call me son, it just turned me off because I didn't have a father, so I was my mother's son. That was the only person I had. But the discipline you need to get, without discipline, you're a slothful, lazy. You've got to have discipline. Discipline isn't shackling you. Discipline isn't forcing you into doing something. It's giving you a direction and a purpose. They say, live a disciplined life. Well, I can't have any fun. I promise you'll have 5,000 times more fun leading a disciplined life than go get them. Aren't we having fun, Ryan?
Yeah.
Doesn't work that way.
I read a quote that said, better have discipline than talent.
Mm-hmm.
Because discipline can be learned, and discipline is what helps you find talent.
That's where he was the master. He took talent and made them discipline.
Yeah, yeah. That, you know, to me, it's you only find talent through discipline.
Mm-hmm. That's really true. That's really a good point.
Yeah. Enthusiasm. You're the most enthusiastic person ever. You turn on this massive energy. How do you keep your enthusiasm, even when you're fatigued, when you're down, when you're tired, when you've gone through the ringer? How do you keep the enthusiasm, even when you have a mountain of critics piled against you?
If it's not real, it won't last. And I'm wondering if it possibly isn't something in our genes. Like, for example, for you to have been successful, you had every reason, every roadblock, everything not to be successful. But something, it wasn't only somebody stimulated you and mentored you. It was greater than that. It was something in your genes. And enthusiasm, you can't, there's been so many charlatans and so many phony people getting up and doing this and giving all their speeches and they're emotional. For example, Adolf Hitler.
Yeah.
Was he enthusiastic?
Yeah.
Enthusiastic for evil. And again, I think that enthusiasm can, how does it last? Can you give enthusiasm to somebody else?
Is it as an innate, the source of enthusiasm? Because you are one of the most enthusiastic. I saw one in the documentary. You jumped higher than Michael Jordan off the court one of your wins.
Oh, yeah, I remember. In the Superdome.
58-inch vertical leap that day.
What makes a person enthusiastic? Should we go back to a book that both of us have read? Norman Vincent Peale, The Power of Positive Thinking.
Yeah.
What are your choices? If you're not enthusiastic, and enthusiastic doesn't mean you have to verbalize it all the time, but your defeat, this really sounds contradictory. I got more stimulated during bad times than I did during good times. I was more ready, more intent. I was interviewing Kenny Rogers one time, the Kenny Rogers, in our Inside LSU basketball show. And I said, Kenny, everybody sees you. You're number one on this, you're number one. How about the climb to the top? And he said, Dale, it's almost impossible to climb that mountain if you don't consistently bounce back from being knocked down and not having a song there. Same thing Matthew McConaughey told me when I talked to him when he came to the office about, you're so real, you're so genuine. He said, yeah, because I know what it's like to be on the bottom. So the enthusiasm stimulated me, he said, to continue. Told me about his stint in Australia. What makes some people enthusiastic? I used to think, oh, I could motivate anybody. No, you can't. You wrote on the board or had it on there. The teacher only appears when the student is ready.
Yeah. So that's fascinating.
Well, let me ask you, you're asking me a question, but let me ask you a question. Does a person that's not enthusiastic and wants to get into Visalis, do they really have a chance? Do you say to yourself, oh, the system can, we can bring them in and stimulate them? Can you?
No, you have to either have an internal source of it or an external source of it, but generally speaking, your environment, you know, the people you surround yourself with, is my experience. My enthusiasm was because I observed characteristics of people that were generally optimistic. My mother, you know, for as much as she went through, she was generally optimistic. My grandmother was always optimistic because she knew that one day she'd be with her Lord and Savior in heaven, and that's all she needed to know. And so I guess it was instilled in me early on, but in my downest of down times, I lost my enthusiasm, but I knew I lost it. So maybe I was aware that I wasn't being the person I was. How about another one? Subject F, this is an interesting one, fame. Dealing with fame. You've coached some very famous players. You've watched young men and women deal with fame in the right way and deal with it in the wrong way. And you yourself, coach, have had a lot, you know, cover of Sports Illustrated, where, you know, Final Four a couple of times, turned around the LSU basketball, had 50,000 people in the Superdome to hear you speak. How have you dealt with it? How have you helped others deal with it?
Fame is a, sounds funny, it can be very destructive. Fame can put you in a deal. Hey, man, I don't have to have the same work ethic. Again, go back to Coach Wooden. I was talking to him one time in his little old modest condominium about mountains of things. We were talking about the fame he's got as a person. Yeah. And how was he affected? And then all the criticism you get from being famous. One thing offline, criticism. And he said to me, Dale, he said, the way I handle it is this. He said, whenever you're in the public eye, take coaching for example, he said, you're going to receive a huge amount of unjustifiable criticism and a large amount of undeserved praise, and you should not be unduly affected by it. Why do you want fame? Do you want fame because you're insecure? Both of us grew up in insecure backgrounds. Do you want fame because you never had anything and now all of a sudden you got fame? Fame is fleeting as heck. If it isn't deeper, I don't even like the word fame. So many people misuse it. Yeah. It's misguided. I think people handle depression and failure better than they do fame. They say, show me fame and I'll show you what it does to a person.
You know, it's interesting. You hear about all these actresses and actors and musicians dying and they have such a terrible life. And you'd think that they have the best life in the world, and yet they're getting addicted to drugs and they're dying, you know, literally left and right every day. We hear another story of another famous person who that became the best of them. And so I agree with you on that. I've always wondered, a person who's had the fame, and you've also had to coach young men and women through ups and downs of their fame and fortune and their careers.
Some people handle fame so well. They take their fame and use it as a platform for good.
Yeah.
Instead of taking the fame and, oh, mirror, mirror on the wall, who's the fairest? I can't hardly kiss that. That isn't what fame should be able to. You should use fame to reach out and help other people, because people want to be around famous people, supposedly, which is kind of sad, because there's an old farmer in North Dakota, probably done more good than a lot of famous people, but nobody knows about him.
Yeah. Interesting. Talk about the game of life. Tell me, you've coached winning teams, you put great game plans together, how you handle the game of life now that you're retired, and you still have the same vitality, you still have the same vigor, from what I can tell, from when you were coaching as you do today retired. So how do you handle it now differently?
The game of life is, it's a never-ending game. It's a game you think you're on top of, or you think you're on top of and then find out you're not, or probably for me, after 44 years of coaching, really, honest to God, Ryan, thinking I'm really trying to do my very best and I thought I wasn't, etc. When I sat back the first year of retirement and looked at my 44-year career, the thing that became the most prominent to me were my limitations, my mistakes, and my distance from the ideal. I have a a young daughter. I saw the picture of little Reagan you flashed up on the screen today, and I can remember her being there. Nobody knows what you do. Do you become famous because you raised a good family? That young child of yours become a good boy? Yeah. We've got a whole total misinterpretation of what fame really is. Can fame be just be a good person or try to help somebody and make the world a better place to live in? Now, you can take fame and do that with it.
Yeah. Yeah. So, okay, let's talk about highs. How do you maximize your highs in life? You're on a winning streak.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, tell me, you've been on plenty of winning streaks before.
Yeah,
how do you maximize those?
How do you
take your highs to the all-time highs, and how do you minimize your lows?
Restrain your ego, and don't have also delusions of grandeur.
So when you're on a run, restrain your ego.
Yes, yeah.
So when you feel you're winning, you're
restrain it.
Restrain your ego.
Look at how many millionaires and billionaires blow fortunes. Yeah. They don't restrain their ego.
Yeah. Well, I can tell you, I've learned that lesson a few times, and I don't plan to learn it again. Talk about your definition of integrity.
Integrity is normally done in silence in your dealings. Integrity is, I really believe we've lost our moral compass. Now, moral, that's got nothing to do with religion or whatever, but our moral compass, integrity. Integrity is if Ryan Blair tells Dale Brown something, it's going to happen,
yeah.
No matter what. There's an integrity that you develop with it. And it seems like we're all manipulating to trying to get, what chess match, what checker can I take away? How can I do this? If you don't have an agenda, and your agenda is to make other people better along with yourself, what's the old saying, leadership? The role of most leaders is to get the people to think more of the leader, but the role of the exceptional leader is to get the people to think more of themselves. That's integrity.
Yeah, that's from the servant.
And boy, are we, sure is.
Yeah.
Are we losing a lot of that?
Yeah, we are. It's fascinating how kids aren't taught integrity, and they don't. No. When you said the moral compass,
you know how you're taught integrity. You're taught integrity by a mother like I had. Welfare, didn't have a penny to her name, no husband, embarrassment, babysitter, clean people's homes. We had nothing. Two times, Ryan, she came back in the midst of winter with the groceries. I can see the sacks, laid them down. She crossed out the peas, bread, milk, what have you. I saw her go over and flip on her winter coat. Mama, where are you going? Oh, the Red Owl gave me 40 cents too much change. I'm going to take it back. I saw her do that twice, take a quarter back to the Piggly Wiggly and 40 cents to the Red Owl store because they gave her too much change.
Yeah.
Now, she didn't get up and say, oh, Dale, I'm going to take the money back.
Yeah.
You know, that's ego. That's vanity.
She
so I saw her integrity. She didn't have to teach it to me by her mouth. I'd rather see a lesson than to hear one any day.
Yeah.
This wasn't necessary. Her actions were.
I remember when I was a young man, when I walked out of the store with a candy bar. And when I got to the car, my mom saw I had the candy bar in my car, 4 years old. And she took me back and made me apologize and made me go through this entire process and show
wow.
So when you talked about your mother's being that example, I got the same one.
Now, please don't misinterpret that. Please don't think that my mother couldn't make me a perfect person. I did the same thing you did as a little boy.
Yeah.
I took a candy bar, didn't have a nickel. I felt so guilty, but I couldn't wait till I sold papers the next day. And I thought, I don't dare go give them that nickel for. I went in and threw it in the Hershey box, thinking, well, they'll find it. It's not a sin.
Yeah, that's great, though. So I guess a good dose of guilt keeps you a high level of integrity.
Yeah.
Here's another one for you. I struggled with the word J when I was jogging my memory here. So I said, John Wooden. Who's John Wooden to you?
John Wooden encompasses a whole bunch of things to me. A dear, dear friend, a grandpa, a father, a coach, and a brother. He has so many qualities that when you leave him, you have a quest to want to be a better person. You say, He never brags about it. He never criticizes anybody. Now, obviously, John Wooden is not without sin. I'm not blind enough to think. But he's such a beautiful person that you judge him also not by his mouth. Every time we're in a restaurant, somebody comes over and pours a glass of water, he'll always turn and say, "Thank you, young man," or "Thank you, ma'am." He'll walk out of a restaurant and see a napkin on the floor. He'll pick it up and put it on the counter. He's described the best, Ryan. In the 13th century, St. Francis of Assisi described him perfectly. He said, "Everyone should preach the gospel every day, and if necessary, use words." There's the answer.
That is great. That's a great reference. K, kindness. You've demonstrated it many times. How do you inspire it?
How do you inspire it in others? I don't know if you can totally inspire it in others. I think you can with your own immediate family more so, and your teams, but to spread it out normally, I think it's very difficult. I saw things. Shaquille did something really sweet. He went to a hospital and saw a dying. He was playing in Indianapolis, playing Indiana. And that particular day of the game, he went to the hospital and spent an hour with his kid. So I called him on the phone the next day after the ball game, and I said, "Shaq, I heard what you did last night, and I just can't tell you how benevolent and nice." "Hold on, coach. Where do you think I learned that? I used to see you do that." Wow, made me feel good. Hey, he and you didn't do that. Kindness, just to have someone, "Oh, isn't he a kind guy?" So, again, by example.
Yeah. It'd be great if people led more by that example on this planet. Mm-hmm. I think all too often people just look past the weak and look past, and don't try to, reach down and help rise other people up. They just move right past them in our society. Longevity. What are your secrets of vitality with age?
Four or five months ago, I thought I had the total answer. I could snap off to you, man. I have never been one, if I did have a little bit of depression or anxiety, I could get over it just immediately by my strength. October 26th, the day after my wife's birthday, I had quadruple bypass surgery. So I went into that operating room, "Let's get this baby over, cut it open, let's get it done." I couldn't believe it was being done because of my nutrition and the way I work out and et cetera, and mental attitude. 6 weeks after that, I felt like the biggest phony and con artist in the world. I said, "Wait a minute, I don't have any energy. I'm sick. I feel terrible. I can't get out of my pajamas." And I thought, "You counterfeit son of a gun. You go all over the country preaching E-Day fix, whatever you fix in your mind, and I don't have the strength to overcome this." It was the hardest thing that I ever did in my life. And there's a time in your life you think you're bulletproof.
Yeah.
Billy Graham, at the end of his career, they said, "What's the most profound thing that you've discovered in the long life you've had?" Without even pondering the answer, he said, "The brevity of life." So when you are sick and suffering, I used to think suffering of that wimp. Brian can't suck up that broken finger. Brian can't suck up this. Yeah. Ryan can't do this. All of a sudden, the loudmouth here couldn't figure out an answer for about 6 weeks.
Well, a quadruple bypass is a tough blow. That's not a broken finger.
Maybe it was vanity. When I think about it, instead of just being the tough guy, maybe I had a little vanity in there too. "Well, I'm not going to grow. Well, I'm going to..." And then to top it all, 3 weeks into being sick, guess who I get a call from? 99-year-old John Wooden.
Really?
To find out how I'm doing.
Yeah.
That stimulated me to get better, by the way. Yeah, it did. It really did.
I recall when Don Yeager told me that you just had surgery. You didn't tell anyone.
No, I didn't.
From what I understand, you went in under an assumed name.
Yeah, I did.
Didn't make it public whatsoever.
I did, right.
And I called you at the home, and you picked up, and I said, "Coach, why didn't you tell me?" And you said, "Because I didn't want anyone to know about it."
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, we're glad to have you. See, feeling healthy now?
Feel much better than I did that first 6 weeks, I'll tell you.
I couldn't imagine, but that's a blessing. Milestones. What milestones did you set for yourself early in your career? How did you use milestones to further your career?
when I came to LSU, which was my first head coaching job, I set some goals. Number one, I wanted to fill the arena. I wanted to make basketball important. Mm-hmm. That goal was accomplished. Two, they hadn't won a conference championship at LSU in 25 years.
Wow.
Quarter of a century, we won the conference championship. Three, I wanted to get a permanent, not just a flash in the pan. We had 17 seasons in a row. I'm going to add an asterisk to that in a minute. 17 seasons in a row, we had none losing seasons, which is almost unheard of. Four, the unheard of thing, I wanted to take a team to the Final Four.
Yeah.
We did that.
Yeah.
Five, I wanted to win a national championship. Four times we were right on the button and didn't. Now you can look back and say, well, you failed. Failed to win the national championship, but would the other things have been done had I not set the sights high, right?
Yeah,
right.
So you set your sights high, and clearly you achieved so much for the state of Louisiana and for the basketball program
right there.
So in the milestones, your advice is set your sights high. Is that what you're saying?
I think you have to. I think you can't have delusions of grandeur, but you can't also underestimate yourself. And I really, honest to God, I believe that there's just, we have so much power, so much ability. I think if we really could comprehend what we can do, we'd literally astonish ourselves. And I don't think we do. We have a tendency to maybe, come on, that swagger and act big, but that's an act. The power inside of us, no one's ever calculated it.
The power inside of us,
no one has ever calculated it.
What's your definition of opportunity?
I have the same opinion Abraham Lincoln voiced years ago. Many people see an obstacle in opportunity, but the bright people see an opportunity in the obstacles. Now that's paraphrased a little bit, but I think that's how you have to look at it. You have to see an opportunity in the obstacles. Let's go back to history. When I was born, Depression, 1935, the dust storms, the lack of jobs, food stamps, and et cetera. Do you know some people that really were positive, came out of there better than any time? And right now, the same thing. The creative people, the people that aren't going to, this is terrible. Look what's happening now. They're not going anyplace, but the creative people, such as yourself, will rise to a higher level than who you were before.
Interesting. So opportunity and obstacles go hand in hand. Both
you sure do.
In the book, Nothing to Lose, I talk about 36 companies.
By the way, I love you like a son, and I would tell you if your book was terrible. That book is so timely in this particular time. It's almost like you knew this was going to happen. So you wrote the book and Nothing to Lose. Everybody should really. Now, it's not the big War and Peace Tolstoy's. It's not 1,000 pages. It's a good, easy read, but it's so common sense. And the other thing I loved about it, you made yourself transparent in the book. And you did. The difference between a suggestion and a decision are light years apart. You don't only suggest. You have some answers for people.
Well, I appreciate that, Coach. You actually inspired it. As soon as you heard my story, you called Don and said you need to write.
I sure did. Yeah.
So I got to tell you, you helped me scratch off a very important goal on my list, and hopefully, it'll be a book that helps change a lot of lives. And it was because of you that happened. So thank you on that. All right, on P. This is something that I struggled with personally. I developed certain talents early on, and I didn't have to prepare to still get a winning score. I didn't write down A through Z in my interviews.
Mm-hmm.
So I found myself not satisfied with my results, and I went back and I said, well, what would John Wooden do? What would Coach Brown do? And the answer was, Coach Brown wrote A through Z before he interviewed John Wooden. So I've done my preparation for this interview.
And they're superb, by the way.
Thank you. What's your standard for preparation? I know you had to prepare a lot as a coach, and I know that, so tell me about your standard for preparation.
In North Dakota, my Lakota Indian friends, I'm using the Sioux Indians, used to say, white man speak with forked tongue.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to speak to you not in forked tongue, but preparation is interesting. Where's the fine line? Chinese proverb years ago said, a genius is a man that knows what to overlook. John Wooden, hundreds of years later, said, failing to prepare is preparing to fail.
Yeah.
So where do you draw the line? Where do you prepare so much that you've got your paper clips in? I'm too organized. I got the paper clips in. I got to have these chairs just right. When we go into my office later today, you won't see any clutter. If knowing what to overlook is a genius, boy, I am totally, I'm at the bottom of the barrel. It's that happy in between. You can go to Las Vegas and roll the dice sometimes and come up with some money, but your preparation isn't going to make that dice any better. But what you prepare here and here is imperative for success.
So how much time did you spend preparing for a game before a game version?
Not enough.
Not enough.
Yeah, not enough. I was too confident I could figure it out in the middle of it. I got bored too easily.
An event like we had today, you filled up many a rooms, many a stadiums, put thousands of people in it. How much did you put into the preparation for those types of things? And what advice do you have to my aspiring entrepreneurs as to how much preparation that you think they should put into before they do an event or before they host an event like this?
I think you have to be careful of not preparing yourself for speaking, that you become plastic, you become artificial. I'm going to do this at this time, or I'm going to raise my arms at this time. I prepare, for example, the speech you're going to hear tomorrow night, which is a difficult speech for a team that finished in the cellar at a basketball banquet.
Yeah.
I thought it over, I wrote it down, I read through it twice, I won't look at it again. Now I'll take that, the notes, but as I'm in the audience, I'll study people. I'll see if somebody's not listening or something. If I have the ability to, I'll walk over maybe and talk to them, put my arm on their shoulder or try to get them involved. So I think you have to be prepared. There's no question about that. But you can be too prepared that you become plastic and artificial, and then you become a charlatan and you're not yourself. I think, and I change my speech like I just did now. I'll think of something that's more important, and I'll forget what I'm saying and go to something else. But I'll change my speech according to the audience, according to a situation that may have happened in that community, that week, that month, to keep it real. And I think to also give analogies like you did today was excellent. To give analogies, hey, this is what I grew out of. I was running from the police, and now I'm paying the police to run. That was an old line that actually happened.
I appreciate it duplicated. That message stuck with you. That's good to hear.
Oh, yeah. It was good.
All right, I got a quiz for you for the letter Q. Did you know, and you like logic, right? Did you
know I love it.
That a little challenge that you inspired helped 10,000 people lose over 1.5 million?
That's absolutely... Today I got an example. We were signing books, and this one guy came up, and he said, I just want to thank you, and he shook my hand. He showed me a picture. The picture, not being disrespectful, he looked like a water buffalo. All of a sudden, you looked at me, geez, pretty flat stomach, and he was proud, and he felt good. So you were the catalyst through your organization. I think that is incredible, and that's the way it should happen. Just one little tiny step and whatever, and boy, all of a sudden it gets to be a challenge. Now we got two guys sitting here, we won't give their names, that almost met that challenge.
There's a lot of people out there.
Say that number again, how many pounds?
10,000 people, 1.5 million pounds to date, and it's not even a year old yet.
Wow.
So probably by the time we get you in Orlando, and we have you come out, that 1.5 million will probably be another 500,000, maybe even as much as another million pounds on that.
And you know what they're doing? They're contributing to society without even knowing it.
Yeah.
Last year, in America, obesity-related illnesses cost this government almost $500 billion, something totally unnecessary. Let's put it into cancer research.
Well, when you think about it, we just got in this big battle over a $650 billion health care bill that we could have wrote the check for by all of us just taking the 10 or 20 pounds.
That's right. No question about it. No question.
You know what? That's Well, that's the irony of where we stand today. It's my parents' time, my grandparents' time. If we knew we could better America by doing our duty, slight duty, not going to war, but just a slight duty, donating our aluminum, the families would donate the aluminum to make sure that we did our service. Now we just need to take off the weight to do our service.
Right. Those that say, well, what can I do? I can just do a little. That's the biggest excuse and the phoniest excuse of all. Even if you can do just a little, do that little.
Well, you did a little. You got me to get on a challenge. And then I did a little, and I got a couple others. And they did a little, who got a couple others. And they did a little, and now that little thing that you did got 1.5 million pounds, and we probably have a billion.
That's wonderful.
To go. But it's a...
Now, that should be national news. We should hear that on TV.
It's a ripple.
See it on TV. Hear it on the radio. Read it in the newspaper.
We will. We will. We're going to do a lot of that. All right. So on R, what's the best remedy for defeat?
Best remedy for defeat. 10 victories.
10 victories?
Never used to make up for one loss. The remedy for defeat is sometimes recognizing, not sometimes, all the time. What you have to, the remedy is recognize how did it happen. If you didn't have enough talent as a coach, if sales are down, you got the wrong people. You need more. You have to analytically examine it, not just be emotional. Well, the referee made a bad call. We didn't get this. So-and-so, the economy went down. You have to analyze that.
So look in the mirror and analyze what went wrong.
There you go.
Take that responsibility.
There you go. There you go. Yep.
Powerful. Okay, under S, are you ever satisfied?
In John Wooden's house again. Sounds like the John Wooden show. We're sitting there late afternoon. And I was telling him, I said, you know, Coach, I'm really disappointed. I really feel that, you know, I could have done better. And when he sees you, he looks at me and he said, well, let me ask you a question. He said, when you were doing it, did you try to do your very best at that moment? Yes, Coach. Then forget about it. He said, you can drive yourself nuts. And he said, you have to do your very best. That's what counts. And it goes back to his father when he leaves little town of Martinsville about John. He said, don't ever try to be better than anyone else, but never cease to be the best you can be. Ryan Blair is trying to be the best he can be. So the trying is the important thing.
So interesting. So you're always attempting to do the best that you possibly can in everything.
Yes.
So that means you're...
And don't play games with yourself.
So what
don't
do you
play,
mean by that?
Don't play games with yourself. Don't con yourself into believing you're doing better Well, that was somebody else's fault.
Yeah.
We have a little disease besides obesity in this country. It's transferring blame.
Yeah.
And it's very easy growing up. Both of us are examples, I'm sure. Wouldn't it have been easy for you to have blamed your dysfunctional family, me to have totally blamed the father that left me? It's real easy to push blame on somebody else. And you have to learn, in order to get over that, you have to learn to move from victim to victory.
Yeah.
You know how you do that? You want a helping hand? Look at the end of your damn arm. Yeah. There it is.
That's my favorite quote.
There it is. There it is.
Okay, on T, I put the word training. Do you still train yourself? Do you still read? Are you still a student?
I will always be. And the more I know, the more I realize what I don't know. Mm-hmm. And then just the small world we live in. How many things there are to learn? Like your business, I'm a terrible businessman. I couldn't do what you're doing. You probably say you couldn't coach, but you are a coach, even though you're not an athletic coach.
Yeah. Knowing what you don't know is an awareness that is very humbling.
Yeah.
Okay, utility is what I put for you. Utility player or a star player? Which would you rather have on your team?
There's a difference between a star and a superstar. I'd want a superstar, more so than a utility player or a star. A star has great statistics. He makes All-American. He's a first-round NBA draft choice. A superstar makes other people better on the court. There are very few superstars. One of them is just gleaming in front of me right now. LeBron James is a superstar. He makes everybody around him better. So I'd like to have a superstar, but they're very hard to find.
So if you were coaching a college team right now and LeBron James was trying out, you'd take him?
Yeah, for a little bribe here and there, I'd take him.
Yeah. You already said this earlier. You said victory under B. So important. What's your greatest victory in your life?
I'm not sure I've really... I think I've done it. The greatest victory in my life is knowing who I am, where am I going, what do I want out of life. And that hurdle, I think you fight that your whole life. I think to make sure, who really am I, where am I going, and what do I want out of life.
When did you get that? When did you know you had that victory? Do you remember, was there an age that you had? That at first you realized who you were, where you're going, and what you wanted out of life?
I had two prominent times. April 15th, 1963. April 6th, the birth of your son. It's a prominent time in your life. When our daughter was born, Robin, on April 15th, 1963, it made me more cognizant of really wanting to contribute and be a real person and just change totally.
The moment that boy, my son, April 6th, showed up in the role, it was 100% different role.
That's right. That's right.
And it began to see thoughts and ideas and philosophies in ways that I never imagined. Yeah. Everyone always told me, you told me, you'll change. You just can't describe it. But well, that's powerful. You said that. Okay, on under X's, I put X's and O's. How much do you sketch out the game plan and tell your players what their role was in any given game plan? How much work did you put on the chalkboard before you went to the court?
Enough to give them a solid vision of what they were going to do, but not enough to restrict them so much. And again, John Wooden was the master at this. He had the right idea to give them enough leniency to play their game, but yet to play it within the construction of what UCLA had set up. They had good one-on-one players. He designed it. I think it's highly overrated. I think the aspects of discipline and the teamwork and putting the team above themselves, as Coach Wooden again said, you got to have some, but I think it's way overrated. And just for example, the teams that consistently win big because of what? Talent.
Yeah.
Putting the team above themselves, getting players that are talented to come into a system. Who could win 10 national championships? Nobody. Only John Wooden. That's exactly right.
Yeah, interesting. So, all right, my last two together are kind of together, Y and Z. Y stands for youth, and Z stands for starting from zero. A lot of times we have young people that are joining entrepreneurship, they're starting very young, or you have people starting from zero, meaning they have to start from scratch, they've had to start a brand new life, gone through bankruptcy, lost their homes, foreclosure, or they're just starting out. Both of them are starting at the same place. So my question is how do you deal with starting from a zero place? And how do you know when you catch that momentum when you get started? So number one is how do you deal from starting from zero, or whether that be that you're a youth or you're starting all over youthful in a new career?
When they snip our umbilical cords, we have been told from the very beginning, we are all created equal. It's not true. Some people have birth defects. Yeah. Some people spend the rest of their life in a wheelchair. Some people have brain damage as a baby. Some people grow up in a wonderful home. Others grow up in alcoholics, narcotics, no home. So that's a myth that we're all created equal, or maybe we are created, but as soon as they snip that umbilical cord, that isn't the way it is. I think starting from zero, there are two things that can drag you down. number one, starting from zero is just saying, hey, I can't do it. I don't have, it's my color, it's my sex, it's my race, it's my economic background. And I think it's, in my opinion, that probably does more. People that put into their mind, you see, what you put into your mind, the goal will never let you go. If you really do have a goal, not a wish, but a will, you'll attract yourself to it. Now, there's going to be, don't ever think the path's going to be clear. It isn't. But to starting from zero, there's no question it's a lot harder, but I think it's a lot more rewarding. Had you been born with a silver spoon in your mouth, you wouldn't have that smile on your face right now. You probably wouldn't have met this woman. You probably wouldn't have this young child. You probably wouldn't be as stimulated as you are now. So it's certainly, for the financial gain, starting from zero, you'd like to not, but yeah, there's some advantages in doing
it. Many of us have to.
Yeah. And youth, do they have it harder now than we had it growing up? Things are a little easier right now. I go, going all over the country with my wife, who's a professional folk dance researcher, go to Romania, see how those people live. We live better than, we're spoiled. We really are spoiled Americans. If you can't make it in America, forget about making it in any other place. You won't do it.
So what do you think? What advice do you have to a young man or woman watching this? How do they separate themselves from the pack? You know, right now the youth have it better than ever. Complacency and laziness is commonplace. I mean, that's the norm as opposed to the exception. What advice do you have? That's your last piece of advice. We conclude the interview. Young man or woman's watching this. What do you advise them to do?
There's a light year of difference, religion and spirituality. I wish we could bring them closer together. I don't know, I go back to my life, I don't know how I could have gotten through tough times had I not had a spirituality in me. To really have to call on a higher power, which is God to me. I'm not embarrassed about it, I'm not gonna talk about it, I'm not gonna profess it. I hope you see it in my life, although you can type in a 3x5 card, the Ten Commandments, and I've had a hard time keeping all of those. It's a very profound question, and it's doggone deep. Let me throw the boomerang back. How would you do it?
I would agree with you. The spirituality, if you were to ask them what's the one ingredient to get a young man or woman right now that's going to get them through, it would be get on your knees and pray every single day and pray that you get better and pray that you grow. And that would be the one piece of advice that I would say would be one size fits all.